Again. Thanks. First of all, organizers, thanks for organizing this and also for inviting me. Thank you. The work I wanted to talk about today addresses the following sort of phenomenon, which arises in a number of non-equilibrium systems. It can happen that you have phase ordering associated with long-range order, like the green and red patches are supposed to be macroscopic patches, long-range ordered. But the system is such that this phase ordering changes rather, you know, on relatively rapid time scales, and it changes shapes of clusters, shapes of macroscopic clusters. And as I said, I'll show you a number of systems in which this happens. The question is, how does one describe this? A system with long-range order, but very large fluctuations, fluctuations as large as the order parameter itself. The work that I'll talk about, recent work that I'll talk about, was done together with Rajiv Kapri and Malay Bandopadhyay. Both of them were postdocs at TIFR when this work started quite a few years ago. But now both are faculty members elsewhere. And this was sort of ongoing work, which started about 15 years ago. And earlier workers who have collaborated with me are Dibyandu Das, Apurva Nagar, Shakuntala, whom you heard yesterday, Satya Mojumdar, who's here, and Manoj. Okay, let me just tell you a little bit about this phenomenon. So as I said, we are talking about phase ordering, so it's approaching a state. We're talking about the approach to a state. Sometimes we'll talk about the state itself. And this has long-range order plus these very large fluctuations. What are the hallmarks of the state? How will you find out if this state is of the class of states that I'm talking about? Well, there are two strong hallmarks. One is that if you look at the two-point correlation function, okay, this shows scaling, as you expect in coarsening systems. But the surprise is about the scaling function. The scaling function is singular and develops generically a cusp singularity at the origin. And this is significant because it signifies the breakdown of the Poron law, which is otherwise expected to hold in most coarsening systems, historically. As I said, these fluctuation-dominated systems actually violate the Poron law. The other manifestation, as something that I mentioned already, large fluctuations of the order parameter, RMS fluctuations, do not die out in the thermodynamic limit, and you actually have well-defined probability distributions for the order parameter. What are examples of such systems? Well, the example that we started out with many years ago, and in fact, this is the example that I'll talk about most today, is passive particles, passive scalars, which are driven by some fluctuating force field. What could the fluctuating driving field be? It could be a fluctuating surface and particles sliding down the surface, or it could be a Burgers fluid, or it could be a membrane on a cell membrane. I'll talk about each of these. And there's very interesting work recently by Madan Rao and others, Madan is here, which talks about this phenomenon in a model of the cell membrane. It also arises in active pneumatics. We heard about active matter yesterday, and I'll show you some evidence of that. And also in granular gases, where you actually approach very inhomogeneous states which have these characteristics. Finally, I'll come to the more recent work, which has to do with the description of order in the state. And what I'll argue is that a single order parameter does not suffice to fully characterize the order. You need a set, in principle an infinite set, which the components of which are quite strongly correlated, and I'll describe some of this. Nevertheless, there's some simple scaling properties which we observe. So this is the agenda. Look on the right-hand side first. This is supposed to be a quick description of coarsening dynamics. So what you do is you start with a system which is at a very high temperature or in a disordered state like here, and monitor the two-point correlation function in that state. Then evolve in time and see what happens. And of course, what happens is that phases grow. You get patches which grow in size, and the two-point correlation function is able to track this growth. And what happens is very nice, that typically the two-point function at a given time is actually a scaling function of the separation divided by essentially the mean droplet size. And this is traditional coarsening dynamics. And the size grows as a power of the time.
So,
yeah, these are coexisting phases. I mean, yes, right. So I'm imagining, for instance, I mean, in this description, something like an Ising model where you have two phases at low temperature, and this is phase growth. However, it can happen in these fluctuation-dominated systems. This is an example, and I'll come to it in more detail later. All I wanted to demonstrate is this cusp here. So this is an example of a system which broadly follows this classical description with size, a typical size that grows as a power of time. But this very nice scaling collapse, and a lot of data collapses onto a single curve. But this curve is not linear. That's significant. And there is a cusp singularity near the origin as goes to zero. And as I said, this signifies a breakdown of the Porod law, which is an important law because it rests on very little. But that little fails here. Yes.
Father, with two brief questions. First, you would expect that the correlation function at r equals zero is one. Why is it not?
Okay. No, this is
the first question. And the second is, before a law comes, you know, from this naive argument, you drop a needle and you evaluate the probability.
Absolutely.
Falls on the interface.
On the interface, correct.
So where is it failing?
Okay, so let.
Sorry.
No. Very important. I would have addressed this later, but let me address it now. First point, correlation function should go to one. You're right. At r equal to zero, the correlation function is one. We are not talking about r equal to zero. We're talking about r by l going to zero. So we are talking about a scaling function, mm-hmm. the limit of the scaling function going to zero. In fact, the intercept will tell you what the long range order is. Because, see, what is long range order? Take two points separated by any distance you like and ask for the two-point function between them. And they could be quite far away. And we need to find the correlation. That will give you the long range order squared. However, take for those two fixed points, let time run. No matter how far these were, so long as they're fixed, as time goes to infinity, L of t becomes much, much larger than any r. Therefore, time going to infinity drives you to the y equal to zero point, and that is the point. So the non-scaling part of this, namely short range, so there is a point at one.
Oh, there is a point at one.
But that's not part of the scaling function, and one should not pay attention to it.
Okay.
Second point, Porod law. Perhaps we'll wait because it will become, what he's saying is absolutely correct. The Porod law can be told to you, I mean, why it happens in 1 minute, as you said, some needle falling. But that fails here. But you have to understand the system better to understand why it fails. Yes. Okay, good. Thank you. Sorry, I should have. The Porod law is a law which due to Parod, and oops, yeah, sorry. Yeah, and it says that essentially it says in this language that the scaling function has to fall linearly.
No, but that's the consequence.
The law is that it falls linearly. I mean, I'm belittling it. It's stated in momentum space as the large Q fall of the structure factor follows Q to the d plus 1. You know, so perhaps the word law is not.
Usually, when people state laws, it's about them.
You take two nearby points, yeah, and you ask, what's the probability of an interface passing between those two points?
Right.
It's proportional
to the separation.
That's Parod's law.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, so this is, perhaps the word law is strong, but it's used. Yeah. Yeah, it rests on the assumption assumption that there is a sharp interface. So this is exactly what fails in these systems. There is no sharp interfaces. The interfaces are macroscopic. Okay. All right. Coming to these fluctuations, well, you see, for instance, in one of these systems, these enormous fluctuations in the order parameter, and we'll come to a characterization of these. But before I come to the systems in detail, let me tell you about some examples that have come to light in the last decade or so, where you in fact have examples of this phenomenon. This is a model of an active nematic. And the model was introduced by Chate and co-workers some time back, but studied recently, or more recently, by Day, Das, and Rajesh. And what they find, I won't go through every one of these figures, is again a scaled correlation function, which again has a cusp singularity, which shows up more clearly in the Fourier transform. This 0.5 refers to another, that does not refer to the cusp, it's the way the system coarsens. But a significant point that they pointed out is that the failure of the linear drop in the correlation function has consequences, those sub-leading consequences, for the way the mean squared fluctuations change as a function of n. Okay, so we will see this point has an important experimental consequence, which probably is in the next slide. Let me see. Yes. So here's an experiment done by Narayan Menon and Ramaswamy some years ago, where they vibrated needles in a trough, and what you can probably see here is large patches of differing density. I don't know if it's visible from there, but here's a less dense patch, here's more dense, etc. And they analyze the number fluctuations in this system, and they had this data. Due to the recent work that they did, they, Das and Rajesh, reanalyzed this data and pulled out from number fluctuations evidence, again, for the violation of the Parod law, in the sense that there are sub-leading corrections which they could actually track from the data. But I'm saying here is experimental evidence, not direct measurement of the correlation function. Unfortunately, that was not done, density-density correlation function. But its implication for the fluctuations enables you to pull out the. Here's one more example. This is the work I referred to earlier, Das, Pauli, and Madan Rao. This is recent work. And what they're describing is the surface of a cell and molecules on the surface. And the idea is that the membrane, the cell membrane, is actually stirred a lot. It's not an equilibrium system. It's stirred by actin activity due to actin molecules there. And those lead to, esters forming. Esters meaning these, places which draw in molecules, but these places which draw in molecules move around a lot. Okay, so this is the rough system. And interestingly, they analyze this model and find a large region in parameter space which where they seem to find fluctuation-dominated phase ordering. They also studied the intermittency, the time variation of the domain sizes, the large domain sizes that form, and found an intermittent signal. And we'll also talk about intermittency in some of these other models a little later. The last example I wanted to tell you is about a freely cooling granular gas. And as you know, in granular gases, rather inhomogeneous structures form. The model studied here was different from the normal things bouncing off with coefficient of restitution, in that the coefficient of restitution, as was recognized by Raman many years ago, actually really depends on the velocity of approach. Because if two balls are hitting each other with zero velocity, they will not restitute, if that's the word. Putting in a velocity-dependent restitution coefficient, they just studied in their model the structures that come out, and indeed found evidence in, this is in momentum space, for fluctuation-dominated result. So I wanted to tell you that this is a real phenomenon. That is, yes. All non-equilibrium, indeed.
And is that intrinsic to this?
Yes, I think it is intrinsic to this sort of phase ordering, indeed. Yeah, that's right. Okay, let me go ahead. Okay, let me come to the passive scalar problem, because this is the problem that I will talk about mostly in the rest of the talk. And you could address it either in the language of the Berger's equation or in the language of KPZ, namely fluctuating surfaces. Here is two alternative pictures and equations that go with it. And there is a mapping, as we know, between a Berger's fluid with velocity v and your height model in that grad H, which was already discussed by Manas and earlier today, which takes you from one to the other. The interesting thing is that if you have a passive problem which is advected by the fluid, then of course its location x sub m changes in time, it's advected, and there could be noise. But that advection maps onto something very physical in the height problem. It just says the particle falls down a slope. So you can think about it, without even calculations. You have a fluctuating surface and particles are falling down slopes, they'll collect into valleys, except that because of fluctuations, valleys will become hills. So this is the correspondence, and here's a picture which is supposed to illustrate that. Okay, let me take a few minutes to connect with some things that we've been discussing all these days, namely coupled driven systems. And the thing is, a passive scalar problem, you have two fields. You have a shaking field and you have a shaken field. So it's a coupled system. How does it fit in within the framework of coupled diffusive systems? Well, you have two conserved fields. So we can write two continuity equations. And that's what's done here. And so sigma and tau are two species, let's say in general. And you can write a current which depends on both, the local density of both. You can expand that in a standard way, and calling delta rho and delta rho sub sigma and tau the deviations of density, and integrating with respect to x, you can write these in terms of heights. And here is one equation written out in some other notation from what we've been using with all sorts of nonlinear terms to second order, and so on. Now, the point I wanted to make is that, of course, this has been made already in Herbert's lectures, but I wanted to reiterate, is that the linear terms determine the stability. So, for instance, if you just look at the 2x2 matrix that I've written here, C11, C12, etc., how did we go to the eigenmodes that Herbert and Manas and others were talking about? Well, we diagonalize the matrix. The eigenvectors tell you the modes. And the eigenvalues tell you the speed of sound. But what if the eigenvalue is complex? Well, what does it mean? It means the following. For instance, if you just look at any system with a and there's some fluctuation somewhere, a kinematic wave, or which we are calling a sound wave in this context, actually moves the fluctuation in time. And that's described by real eigenvalues of this matrix. So C plus and C minus being real will correspond to waves. On the other hand, if you have a complex eigenvalue, and then you might have an instability. And then, of course, the fluctuations grow in time. And you can have big phases forming. The case I'm interested in for my passive problem is the case C21 equal to 0. This term is absent. So you cannot further diagonal, I mean, this matrix cannot be diagonalized. But that is, if you like, the passive scalar problem. Now, we can put all these things in terms of a phase diagram. I hope that's, that's not next yet, but okay, I'll define it. Okay, so I'm going to work with a specific model. So let me describe the model. The model has two components. It has particles and holes, therefore, also. And it has tilts. It's the following. So here are particles, here are holes. And these are tilts, which are local slopes of the surface. So the way the particles move is either facilitated or not facilitated by the surface tilt. And that's embodied in this set of rules. The rules basically state that particles prefer to fall down and not go up. And it also, in general, the surface can respond to the particle. And something on with a particle, the surface tends to fall. A local hill might become a local valley. But you can change these rules around. Now, so if you suppose you define rates which go along with these processes, the nature of the steady state depends on these two parameters. Let me keep on with it for a minute. And let me show you a phase diagram. In the end, I'm going to look at only one portion of the phase diagram today, that is this line. But I just wanted to point out that this model is rich enough to give you three phases. One is the wave phase that we have been discussing in the lectures on fluctuating hydrodynamics. There are actually waves. And it turns out there's a loci in this phase diagram where we can find the steady state, where we could have we found the steady state exactly. And on the other hand, on the other side, the unstable side, there is this phenomenon of strong phase separation studied earlier by David and others, as well as Larry and Ramaswamy, and talked about by Shakuntala yesterday. And again, there's a locus on which we know the phase, sorry, the steady state, steady state exactly. In between these is this line. It's not a wave phase with sort of mixed up things, nor is it a phase. It's the in-between phase, which is fluctuation-dominated phase order. So let me show you some pictures of phenomena in all the three phases. Yes?
When C12 or C21 is 0,
yes.
That is, where is that? That is on the...
That is that brown line.
Okay.
Indeed, that is that separatrix, and that's the object of my interest. And that's this picture. Right. So left-hand side, that blue phase, is corresponds to a picture like this. Now, can you all see waves? I mean, these are just simulations, I mean, of the model that I described. And they show waves going in two directions. And, sorry?
They look like fabric
designs. Yeah, maybe we can patent this. Let's see, KPZ for fabrics.
Nice,
yeah.
Carpet,
thank you. All right. Yeah, no, actually, that's a thought. Yeah, and I mean, I can tell you more about the colors. There's a story to, but we will not get into that now. Yeah, right. No, but the colors you see are not the colors we ask the computer to print. I mean, they're hybrid colors because these are eigenmodes. So they actually combine the colors. It's quite nice, you know. So, right. Now, of course, just one more remark about the wave phase, the waves themselves are typically KPZ-like. We've verified that in detail. But on reminding me of Manas's discussion on charge and spin with two different symmetries, again, in this space, you can identify the symmetries. And there are indeed loci along which one wave is KPZ, the other is linear with cubic nonlinearities. When you have an Edwards-Wilkinson cubic equation, cubic nonlinearities are irrelevant, but they're marginally irrelevant. And therefore, they actually dress up the power laws with multiplicative logs and numerically important. So we've analyzed that part. Okay, just to let you know. Strong phase separation, of course, very robust, very nice, pure phases, etc. But here is the system of our interest. So you see something like phase separation, like patches, but they're not well-formed. They come, they go, they do something else. You know, so this is the state we really want to describe. So the rest of the talk will be about this now. So let me get going. Sorry. Yeah, so here is the model. Again, so I have particles which are performing biased random walks along local gradients. The surface evolves, but it is unaffected by the particles because I'm describing a passive scalar problem. As I said, we have studied the full phase diagram where it can affect the surface in different ways, but let's not do that today. Let me look at the time. Only 13 minutes of us? Or 13 minutes left? Sorry. Okay. No, I have to renovate something. Yeah. Thank you. I won't describe each and everything here, but I wanted to say there's a caricature model that we built, which we called a depth model or a coarse-grained depth model of the surface, in which we imagine that if you have a fluctuating surface, go to the adiabatic approximation. You know, hold the surface, let the particles find their ground state. And then, of course, you have a way of analyzing what this state is. So our analytical calculations have to do with this caricature. Okay. So way back in the year 2000 and 2001, Divyendu, Satya, and I studied this problem, and I've already talked about this cusp singularity, so let me not repeat it. We analyzed and found these values numerically. The value of the cusp exponent depends on the universality class of the shaking. For the Edwards-Wilkinson model, first of all, of course, Z is 2, or 3 by 2 in the two cases, but beyond that, the cusp exponent alpha depends on that, and it's 0.5, roughly 0.5 for Edwards-Wilkinson driving. It's about a quarter for KPZ driving. For the depth model, we can work this out. One dimension. Sorry, one dimension from now on, largely. One dimension.
KPZ, why do you get Z equals 2?
No, we get Z equal to 3 by 2.
Oh, okay.
No, so as I said, Z can switch from 2 to 3 by 2, it does, but the cusp exponent is also affected, which is not surprising, but we don't have a theory for 0.25 here.
The depth model has sharp interfaces, so why?
No, this is important. The depth model does not have sharp interfaces between phases. By a phase, I made a macroscopic stretch. If you look at a macroscopic stretch, that's a phase, and what's in between, of course, has sharp interfaces, but there are many, many of them. Yeah, yeah, that's the point, yeah. Okay, right. Let's spend a minute on this. Two-point correlation functions is very good, everybody likes them, but what about one-point correlations? That's the order parameter. So that is what we wanted to study. So we actually, sorry, was there a question? No. Looked at the density, and since it's conserved, we look at Fourier components of that, in particular long wavelength, but also short wavelength Fourier components. This is what we find. So we define these components, and here is a plot. So just look at this for a minute. This is K, momentum. this is Q of k, the Fourier transform, at each k. Now, at each value of k, this is increasing system size, the signal goes to zero. I mean, it just drops. But look at the lowest Fourier mode. It's nicely approaching a limit. But then look at the second lowest Fourier mode. It's also approaching a limit, and the third and the fourth. These limits are important because they survive in the thermodynamic limit. And they characterize the order. So Q sub 1 is this Fourier mode, and it's picking out the density component there. And well, it has a nice robust value. It's 0.18. And a perfectly ordered system would have 0.32. But OK, this is fine. However, notice these fluctuations. So let me, let me go back here for a minute. You can see the order parameter has a mean value, but it fluctuates up and down. In particular, it reaches zero quite often. And that was worrisome, because does it mean the order is destroyed? So this was a realization that took us some time. It does not mean the order is lost. It simply means the following, that the first Fourier mode picks up clustering on roughly L by 2 size. But what is happening, and so this we checked, is that whenever the first Fourier mode dips down, this is the red curve, the second and third pick up. So it's physically very simple. You have a large cluster evolving in time. Sometimes it breaks up into two pieces, and the two clusters go away. The second mode, I mean, m equal to 2 picks it up. Then they rejoin. Then they break apart, sometimes into 3, more rarely into 4, etc., etc. But never into a disordered state. You know. So this is the point here. Yes, this is, I'm going to give you evidence of that. This will survive in the thermodynamic limit. And this is what I'm, I'm just repeating the same thing that I said 1 minute ago, but in terms of a picture. So here's M equal to 1 subspace in some schematic space, and here's 2 and 3, and here's disordered. So the system actually wanders around here, largely with 1, but sometimes 2, sometimes, but never reaches a disordered state. So it's in a basin of ordered states, and it's circulating there. So coming back to your question about thermodynamic limits, so this is the sort of size scaling that we have investigated for these Fourier modes. So I have 6 minutes. OK, let me proceed. These are the sorts of curves we've seen already. And these are, of course, what I've plotted here in each of them are mean values of the Fourier signal. And those have very nice scaling properties. Essentially, all of them collapse onto scaling. So what are we saying? The one-patch order, the two-patch order, the three-patch order, each is characterized by M. Each is also a function of system size. I mean, you know, the Fourier something. So the sort of a natural question to ask then is, how do these intercepts fall with M? How does the curve also approach zero far away? So what we are saying is that there's good scaling with the mode number and system size in this way, with non-trivial exponents, which we so far do not understand or have a theory for. But we actually have good evidence of scaling. So this is some recent preprint of ours. But if the mean value scale, we would ask, what about the full probability distributions of the order parameters? So for m equal to 1, 2, 3, do they scale as well? And the answer is yes, they do. So here is evidence for, so this is different Fourier modes. So what we are plotting is the P of QM, the probability of the Fourier mode, in an more or less in the largest systems we can study. And there is good collapse as a function of system size that we have seen with the mean. And the, but now we're asking for different ends. And again, there's a simple scaling collapse for the, there is a scaling collapse, of course, with the same exponents phi that I defined in the previous transparency in all three cases.
Mode one is
a very bad actor. Yeah. We've left it that. Mode one and mode two is also not so good, except sometimes. But it's scaling, so you expect this to hold for large m.
So it's a large m.
It's okay. Supposed to be really valid for large m, but in the
it works down to
yeah, but not one. One is a very bad actor. Yeah. Thanks. Dynamics. Okay, now I have 4 minutes, and let me quickly tell you. We've actually studied the dynamics in these systems also. First of all, we started out with studying local dynamics, not the order parameter dynamics, and this was the work of Shakuntala some years ago in 2006. And what we looked at is the autocorrelation function. That's all. And of course, she did more, but today I'll talk only about the autocorrelation function. That also shows a cusp. So cusps is the order of the day. I mean, here is some data for that. For the depth model, we can actually calculate the, with Edwards-Wilkinson dynamics, we can calculate the autocorrelation function. Here it is. And for small t over L squared, indeed it's a cusp, tau to the quarter. Numerically, we have determined these as well. But what about the order parameter? Well, in the order, see now, there's not one order parameter. There's a whole lot, Q1, Q2, Q3. And it's clear from the outset that they are anti-correlated. Why? Because when you have one patch, you can't have two. So when Q1 is large, Q2 must be small. So here is evidence for anti-correlation and further evidence for scaling. So we've plotted the scaled CMNs defined thus and shown that there are collapses. Okay, let me rush on. We also measured structure functions for everything inside. So there are these models and the three types of models and two types of dynamics. And so we have data for all.
Now it's all at equilibrium, not during course.
This is all in equilibrium in the steady state, right? Yeah. And indeed, there are very clean power laws here as well. Perhaps the last slide now, or I think it's the last, again, analyzes another question related to the structure factors. Namely, you know, look at the plot for the order parameter. It's going up and down there. And the question is, is this obeying simple scaling, the time series, or is it intermittent? The difference between the two, of course, is the following. When you have a simple scaling, if you have a time window and you try to reduce the time window, fluctuations, the largest fluctuation you'll see in that smaller time window will be smaller than the ones you saw in the larger one. Not so with intermittency. And that is associated with large crashes. You know, so if you have large crashes, you know, you can, violate simple scaling. And this is evidence to show that, at least in the depth model, there is a weak divergence in something called the flatness, which is simply this kurtosis-like object, and that indicates intermittency. Okay. Last word to tell you all, with the non-interacting particles, rather than particles with hardcore interactions, I didn't emphasize this, my particles had hardcore interactions all throughout. I should have said that in the beginning because they're particles and holes. But if you have non-interacting particles, this is the classic passive scalar problem. And we've studied that, and what we find in one word is that the scaling function is still singular, but the singularity is much stronger. It's a divergence near the origin. And we are able to characterize that. We are also in the thermodynamic limit, in this work with Apurva Nagar, Satya, and myself, we showed that that relates to the Sinai problem of quench disorder, where you can actually calculate the correlation function and show that it has a divergence. Okay, so with that, I think I'll just put on the last I hope it's the last. Yeah. Transparency and, you know, just read the big red things and that's enough. I think we'll just leave it. Thank you. Ah, zero. Okay, good. Thank you.
Questions? Marks? You say that the dynamical correlation functions are in the steady state.
Yes.
But it always coarsens. That's because you have finite system.
Yes, correct. Yes, so two remarks. I mean, what I showed today was the steady state results, so in a finite system. And then, of course, we can keep making the system bigger. But there is always scaling with the system size. So basically what happens is that the coarsening length L of t gets replaced by the system size in steady state. Second, however, Shakuntala also studied the approach to steady state and the question of aging. It turns out that these models actually show aging, and we can calculate quite a lot of things in that regime as well. So, you know, I personally believe there's something I don't know for a fact, but there's a relationship between this class of systems and quenched disordered systems. It shows up in several hints here and there, like the Sinai model. You know, it's a model of quenched disorder. It's the adiabatic limit of our system. Nevertheless, it describes very well. I mean, I didn't show you the agreement. The agreement with the highly non-equilibrium systems we are studying. I mean, it works remarkably well. So I think there's a, you know, basically what this fast dynamics is doing is taking you through realizations of disorder without always equilibrating, but then it doesn't matter. Anyway. Yes.
I'm slightly confused in the regime where you have complex eigenvalues. Is there any other steady state over which, if you linearize, you get real eigenvalues in that regime? Or, I mean, you when you linearize about unstable background, then you get complex eigenvalues, right?
No. When you linearize about a homogeneous background.
Homogeneous background, you get complex.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
that's
it's
right.
Not stable.
Yeah, yeah.
But is there some other background over which, if you linearize it, you may get real eigenvalues?
Yeah,
is
sure.
Possible?
Basically what it's saying is that if you started with the homogeneous thing, it will, the linear theory will show you it's unstable.
Right.
But then you let it be unstable, you let it reach steady state, this is the steady state. Now if you linearize around here, right, you will be in good shape.
And then you will, then you can still, then you'll get all real eigenvalues, and then
yes,
you can get again write nonlinear fluctuating hydrodynamics.
Maybe. Except these are very strongly phase separated, so there's not much fluctuation here. Right. The only fluctuation you might see is at the interfaces. So these are very strongly robust phases. It's like the pure phases that Shakuntala talked about yesterday.
But the interfaces can behave.
Yeah, the interfaces are, well, you know, the interfaces are very, yeah, there's some action at the interfaces. Thank you.